MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about a case which is going to illustrate the need for understanding laboratory data. Okay, so let's get started. We have a 60-year-old Caucasian male who presents with diarrhea and hypotension, fever, chills, and dizziness. Vital signs, his temperature is 38.3. His pulse is 135. His respirations are 30. And his blood pressure is 85 over 55. On physical examination, he is alert and oriented times 1 to 2. He is lethargic. On head, ears, eyes, nose, and throat examination, it is clear, but his mucous membranes are dry. On cardiovascular exam, he is tachycardic. And on lung exam, he has clear to auscultation bilateral lung fields. On abdominal exam, it is tender to the left lower quadrant, but no rebound. And on extremity exam, there is no clubbing cyanosis or edema. Laboratory values look like this. His white blood cell count is 55.0. His hemoglobin is 16.0. His platelet count is 85. And his hematocrit is 48.0. His chemistries look like this. His sodium is 145. His potassium is 3.0. Chloride is 115. His bicarbonate is 13. His BUN is 30. His creatinine is 1.5. And his glucose is 200. Chest x-ray is clear. And the KUB is nonspecific. He gets a CT scan of the abdomen, and it shows wall thickening in the sigmoid colon. You ask further history, and the patient has had a UTI in the past for which he has gotten antibiotics. Okay, so by this point, some of you would probably already know the diagnosis here. This guy, just looking at him, there's several things that you can look at. You can see that his blood pressure is low and that his pulse rate is high. This is consistent with hypovolemia, but it's also consistent with septic shock. And given the fact that the white blood cell count is definitely elevated, would lead you to that. The kind of IV fluids that you would want to give are resuscitative fluids so that you could expand the volume. One appropriate type of IV fluid would be normal saline. However, there's recent evidence that shows that giving balanced fluids, especially in patients with renal insufficiency, will be beneficial. And so another probably more appropriate fluid would be lactated Ringer's or LR. Another one that you could give would be half normal saline with 75 milliequivalents of sodium bicarbonate. So what you're doing here is instead of just giving pure chloride, you're giving a lactated Ringer's or bicarbonate solution, okay? Now, if the MAP does not increase to greater than 65, then you're gonna probably have to start some vasopressors through a central line and resuscitate this patient. Now, looking at this hemoglobin here, I can see clearly that this is an elevated hemoglobin for somebody who is so sick, and this is probably showing hemoconcentration. Here, the low platelets are probably a result of septic shock. We could check that out by looking at the PTINR and PTT to see if they were elevated, and also the fibrinogen level if that was low. This is the hematocrit. It's usually gonna be three times that of the hemoglobin. Let's look at the chemistry here. We've got the sodium and the potassium, the chloride, the bicarbonate, the BUN, and the creatinine, and then we have the glucose. So the first thing that you want to look at is the sodium and the potassium. Here I can see that the sodium is elevated. That usually means that there's some amount of dehydration, which goes along with what we're seeing here already. This very high white blood cell count, by the way, is usually indicative of just a few things. And specifically, because we're dealing with sigmoid colonic wall thickening, the big thing that you have to think about there is C. diff. C. diff colitis, and there are only a few antibiotics that can treat that. Also, with relation to the history of antibiotics in the past, that also puts it together. So why would the patient have a low potassium? Because the patient has diarrhea, and that's going to get rid of a lot of potassium. It's also going to get rid of some water and volume. That could be the reason why the patient is hypernatremic or on the border of being hypernatremic. Clearly here, the patient has a low bicarbonate, which is indicative of a metabolic acidosis. And whenever you consider or entertain the possibility that the patient has a metabolic acidosis, you need to calculate the anion gap. So we add here 115 to 13, and we come up to 128. And 128 from 145 is an anion gap of 18. So that's an elevated anion gap. What could that be from? Well, I can tell you that the patient had a lactic acid level of approximately 5, and that could explain why the patient's lactic acid level and anion gap, therefore, is elevated. But if we add the lactic acid level to the bicarbonate and say, okay, let's say that the lactic acid went away and it went to normal, this would only raise our bicarb to that of 18, which means that it's well still below 24, which is where it should be. And that means that we have a non-anion gap metabolic acidosis as well, which is probably related to the diarrhea. So I think what we have here based on the labs and the radiographic findings and the vital signs is somebody clearly in septic shock from C. diff colitis who is very dehydrated. He needs brisk resuscitation. You want to avoid normal saline, I think, in this case, because that's simply going to exacerbate your non-anion gap metabolic acidosis. So giving some sort of lactated ringers or bicarbonate is going to be probably advisable. That's going to help your resuscitative events. It's probably going to help out with your kidney function. You're going to have to make sure with that resuscitative effort that you're aggressively replacing potassium, because the potassium is only going to fall once you correct the acidosis and you resuscitate the patient correctly. Now, a lot of these things that we've just discussed about, if you are completely lost here, there are a number of lectures that I want to direct your attention to, many of which are on our MedCram channel at YouTube. But also, I want to direct you to MedCram.com, and we actually have a new series which gets into the idea of understanding what a CBC can tell you and all the different possibilities. So look for that. Also, we have a series on vasopressors that talks about which vasopressor you would want to add, and also regarding interpretation of chest x-rays. In addition, we also talk about septic shock, and that's clearly something that this patient has. We also talk about tackling every single type of acid-base disorder in our acid-base series, where we talk about lactic acidosis, we talk about figuring out the anion gap, and how to calculate all of the different types of acid-base disorders that you can have in a patient. Well, with that, thank you for joining us.